Welcome to New Hanover County Schools, The Morning Show. I'm July Alexander.
And I'm Trevor Kerrigan. This is the week of September 21st through September 27th, and this is our first show of the year.
We hope everyone has had a fantastic summer. Now school is underway and we're all back in the swing of things.
We're excited about our new season, which includes a new format, new features, new news, and as always, tons of new fun.
This year we are bringing back some of the old favorites like A-plus Teachers and the Zoo Files. We have some exciting segments including Science Nation from the National Science Foundation and Bell Ringers from C-SPAN Classroom.
As always, we'll also bring you the weekly school lunch menu, upcoming events, and our fan favorite long-running series, This Week in History.
It's going to be another amazing and exciting season of The Morning Show, so be sure to tune in every morning here on the Learning Network.
And yet another great feature of the morning show are the news stories from our sister show, Your School News. The third member of our team this week is our news anchor, Gabrielle Ellen.
That's right, she is standing by right now with our first look at Your School News headlines. Good morning, Gabrielle.
Good morning, July and Trevor, and welcome everyone to Your School News here on the morning show. Topping the headlines this week, NHCS 2014-15 Ready Assessments results are in. Ashley students selected as finalists in Broadcom Masters Competition, and National Pond donates music instruments to Virgo. I will have all these stories and more coming up later in the show.
Thanks, Gabrielle. We get things going today with a staple here on the morning show with a segment we call This Week in History. Our Grand Master of Historical Knowledge has all the headlines from the past times in This Week in History, brought to you by Kidsville News.
Welcome to This Week in History. I am your historical host, Samantha Klein, covering all the colorful and amazing events that have left their mark on history's timeline. This is the week of September 21st through September 27th. September 21st, 1780. During the American Revolution, American General Benedict Arnold commits treason. He meets with the British to discuss handing over West Point in return for a large sum of money and a high position in the British Army. The plot was foiled, and Arnold, a former American hero, became synonymous with the word traitor. September 22nd, 1554. Famed Spanish explorer Francisco Coronado, whose health badly deteriorated from injuries and the toll of his strenuous travels, dies. He never found the fabled cities of gold that he had sought for decades, but he did manage to explore the southern half of the present-day United States. September 23rd, 1845. The Knickerbocker Baseball Club of New York was formed by Alexander Dory Cartwright. It was the first baseball team in America. September 24th, 1960. The USS Enterprise becomes the world's first nuclear-powered aircraft carrier. Although still part of the U.S. Navy, it was scheduled for decommissioning in 2014 and still holds the record for the longest naval vessel in the world. September 25th, 1957. Under escort from the U.S. Army's 101st Airborne Division, 9 black students enter all-white Central High School in Little Rock, Arkansas. 3 weeks later, the Arkansas governor had surrounded the school with troops to prevent its federal court-ordered racial integration. Finally, your weekend history tidbits. September 26, 1960. The first televised debate between presidential candidates took place. Richard M. Nixon and John F. Kennedy faced off in Chicago, but it was seen across the nation. September 27, 1938. President Franklin Roosevelt writes to German Chancellor Adolf Hitler regarding the threat of war in Europe. In the letter, Roosevelt reiterated the need to find a peaceful resolution to a possible German invasion of Czechoslovakia. That's This Week in History, your ultimate source for those key moments in time. I'm Samantha Klein. Thanks for stopping by.
This Week in History is brought to you by Kidsville News, a fun and effective learning resource for children, teachers, and parents. Kidsville News is always free. Copies are delivered each month to every elementary school in New Hanover County School System.
And join us again next time for another journey through time as we explore the fun, fascinating, entertaining, and educational facts that make up This Week in History.
We have plenty more of the morning show ahead, including the Zoo Files and our new segment, Science Nation.
Don't go away. We'll be right back after this short break.
If you're looking for a new pet that your family will cherish every day, consider adopting from a shelter. Shelters are the best places to find a new pet. That's where you'll discover healthy, loyal, and loving animals, eager to become a part of your family. A person is the best thing to happen to a shelter pet. So bring home your new buddy today. To find out more, visit theshelterpetproject.org.
They told me a bottle couldn't dream. That I would never become a superhero. But I learned how to fly. Just to come back in a new disguise. And be the hero that I've always wanted to be.
King.
Go fish.
The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today.
And best friends.
I love my sister.
My heart doesn't see race. Love is love.
Our family is no less than any other family.
Love is kind. Love is patient.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. I'm July Alexander.
And I'm Trevor Kerrigan.
Constitution Day was September 17th, and in honor of that day, we have a great facts and information to share with you about that founding document.
Constitution Day commemorates the signing of the Constitution of the United States. The Constitutional Convention took place in Philadelphia from May until September 1787. It's not only the oldest constitution, but also the world's shortest constitution, consisting of only 4 pages and containing only 4,400 words.
The U.S. Constitution established America's national government and fundamental laws and guaranteed certain basic rights for its citizens. It was signed on September 17, 1787, by delegates of the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia, presided over by George Washington.
The original 13 states, with the exception of Rhode Island, appointed 70 delegates to the convention. However, only 55 could attend. Their mission was to revise the Articles of Confederation, which was the founding document before the Constitution.
The delegates devised a plan for a stronger federal government with 3 branches, executive, legislative, and judicial, along with a system of checks and balances to ensure the single branch would not have too much power.
In 1789, James Madison introduced 19 amendments to the Constitution. 10 of those amendments, known collectively as the Bill of Rights, were ratified and became a part of the Constitution on December 10, 1791.
The Bill of Rights guarantees individuals certain basic protections as citizens, but the contributions to the drafting of the Constitution, as well as its ratification, Madison became known as the father of the Constitution.
There have been thousands of proposed amendments to the Constitution. However, only 17 amendments have been ratified in addition to the Bill of Rights. The most recent amendment to the Constitution was Article 27, which deals with congressional pay raises. It was proposed in 1789 and ratified in 1992.
Today, the original Constitution is on display at the National Archives in Washington, D.C.
We hope you enjoyed learning about the Constitution.
It's time for our first block of news. Let's send it over to Gabrielle, who has several interesting stories to report. Good morning, Gabrielle.
Good morning, and welcome to Your School News on the Morning Show. I'm Gabrielle Allen de Trois-Maisons. Our top story this week, New Hanover County Schools has announced the 2014-15 results for the READY assessments. The assessments are based on standards which gauge grade-level proficiency and career and college readiness measures. These measures address how equipped students are for college and careers, and whether students are on track to be ready by high school graduation. With a complete report on the assessment is YSN reporter Bobby Blue.
The READY assessment numbers are in, and in merely 5 years, New Hanover County Schools has had a 10.4% increase in the graduation rate, with significant improvements this past year for limited English proficient, economically disadvantaged, students with disability, and multiracial students. The numbers in the assessment are broken up into five categories: performance composite, growth, career and college readiness, annual measurable objective, and school performance grade. The district's performance composite for all end of grade and end of course assessments combined is 63.4%, well above the overall state average. New Hanover County Schools' performance composites on all end-of-grade and end-of-course assessments surpass the statewide results for both grade-level proficiency and career and college readiness standards. The growth measure for all elementary schools met or exceeded growth expectations in 2014-15. In fact, New Hanover County Schools met or exceeded growth expectations higher than the state's rate of 72%. With an emphasis on college and career readiness, the new READY model includes five additional indicators at the high school level. New Hanover County School students' performance on the new college and career measures featured both highs and lows. The AMO status is a federal requirement and tracks the progress of student groups. As a district, New Hanover County Schools met 78% of the targets as compared to the state at 55%. Finally, in the category School Performance Grade, New Hanover County Schools topped the state in the percentage of schools achieving grades A through C. In 2014-15, schools had the opportunity to earn A+ for their school performance grade. 7.9% of New Hanover County Schools achieved the new A+ designation, and when compared to the state, the district has a higher percentage of A+ through C schools. For a complete overview of all the numbers in this year's READY assessment, you can visit the school system's website at www.nhcs.net. Reporting for Your School News, this is Bobby Blue.
Two New Hanover County Schools teachers were selected to join a panel discussion at New Hanover Regional Medical Center's 4th Annual Pediatric Compassionate Care Conference last week. Jay Robinson, home hospital teacher, and Katherine Bryant, specially designed academics teacher at Parsley Elementary School, joined the interactive panel discussion, Hoisting the Sails, Every Child Deserves to Go to School. The panel focused on the community effort to support students with chronic illness and disabilities. Elizabeth Ellie Kinsey, currently a freshman at Ashley High School, has been selected as one of 30 finalists in the 5th Annual Broadcom Masters Math, Applied Science, Technology, and Engineering for Rising Stars Middle School Competition. Ellie was selected based on her science fair project, Water Pollution and the Eastern Oyster, which she completed as an 8th grade student at Murray Middle School.
So for my project, I looked at how pesticides and fertilizers and a lot of things that are in runoff affected the growth of juvenile oysters. And basically I found that fertilizers had a very negative impact on juvenile oysters, which is probably the same impact that they would have on a bunch of other marine life that could live in areas where runoff is a big problem.
Finalists like Ellie were selected by a panel of distinguished scientists and engineers from among 300 semifinalists and 2,230 applicants in 47 states and 2 territories. Ellie travels to the Broadcom Masters October 1st through 7th in Silicon Valley, California to showcase her project for the public and compete in teams with other finalists in hands-on STEM activities. She has a chance at winning a grand prize of $25,000. For all of the latest on New Hanover County Schools, join us weekdays at 5:30 p.m. here on Time Warner Cable Channel 5 and Charter Cable Channel 191 for your school news, a complete half hour of all the latest news and information from New Hanover County Schools. Now back to your hosts.
Thanks, Gabrielle. In addition to watching your school news and the morning show, you can see many of NHCS TV's programming online.
Just go to the school system's website at www.nhcs.net and click on the NHCS TV logo right there on the front page.
You can watch great programs there like Diversity Matters, The Forum, and Up Front with the Superintendent.
It's an excellent way to watch our programming whenever you want.
Shifting gears now, we have everyone's favorite segment from the North Carolina Zoo at Asheboro. The Zoo Files tells us all about the different animals, exhibits, and happenings at the zoo.
The North Carolina Zoo has always wanted their visitors to do more than just view animals. Education is an important part of their mission, and today on the Zoo Files, we learn about the role of the zoo's animals ambassadors who help with educational programs.
For people visiting the North Carolina Zoo, seeing our animals enhances their learning experience. But the zoo's education department has a collection of animals called animal ambassadors, which give kids an up-close and personal experience. Those animals are not on exhibit, but zoo education animal caregiver Hannah Decker has more on how your kids can see the animal ambassadors and what valuable lessons the creatures are teaching kids.
An animal ambassador is a live animal present during an education program. Animal ambassadors are so important because they serve as a catalyst for learning. By capturing the audience's interest, they're easily visible, close at hand, and usually active. They increase learning, and they also can help to change attitudes about environmental issues. The North Carolina Zoo education staff offers a variety of programs, both on and off-site, for education purposes. Everything from zoo snoozes and birthday parties and camps during the summer, summer library programs off-site. In 2015, Kid Zone's going to be open from April through October, and Thursdays through Sundays and holidays, we offer 2 animal encounter programs a day. Also, people can see these animal programs by going to the zoo's website, nczoo.org, clicking on the education tab, and seeing the numerous different activities and programs offered both on and off site. This is a great time of year for our visitors to come out and visit the zoo. It's beautiful and we have a lot of things to offer.
Whether it's here at the zoo or off site, animal ambassadors are definitely enhancing the way kids learn about wildlife. To learn more about our animal ambassadors, check out our website, nczoo.org. I'm Gavin Johnson reporting for Zoo Files, connecting your life to wildlife.
The North Carolina Zoo near Asheboro is open year-round. For more information, call 1-800-488-0444 or visit the zoo website at www.nczoo.org.
That was another excellent edition of the Zoo Files. Thank you, Gavin. From zoo news to science news, we are thrilled to bring you the National Science Foundation's online magazine, Science Nation. In this feature, they examine the breakthroughs and the possibilities for new discoveries about our planet, our universe, and ourselves. Each week, Science Nation takes a dynamic, entertaining look at the research and the researchers that will change our lives.
You might call him Lord of the Rings. The tree ring lab is hands-on, and so we encourage everybody to touch these pieces of wood. This is a cross-section of a redwood tree.
David Staley is a dendrochronologist at the University of Arkansas.
The annual growth rings in trees are a natural archive of environmental history. The time series history of fat rings and skinny rings is telling you about the history of wet years and dry years. So this is a piece of African bloodwood. This was found in western Zimbabwe.
Long before high-tech weather instruments, nature has kept precise records of rain, drought, even fires.
The climate history encoded in the annual rings of trees is unique. It's like fingerprinting.
With support from the National Science Foundation, Staley is helping Mexico prepare for future droughts by looking at how trees responded to severe drought in the past. That will help fine-tune predictions about how future dry spells will impact the ecosystem and could help the country prepare for future water and energy needs.
One notion is that this 21st century drought may be being aggravated by human activity, both at the global scale and at the regional scale due to land surface changes.
Deciphering tree rings can also help historians solve mysteries, like the fate of the New World's lost colony of Roanoke. Could drought have been a factor?
This is a piece of bald cypress from Blackwater River, Virginia. That is the most severe drought of 800 years in this part of the United States. And that's a significant year because of the disappearance of Virginia Dare and the other colonists at the Roanoke colony in North Carolina. This is a Swedish increment borer, and with this tool we can extract a core sample without seriously harming the tree.
In the field, Staley and his team target old growth forests with the least imprint of human activity.
Oh man, these are stupendous trees. They're so precious.
And that's a ringing endorsement from this Lord of the Rings. For Science Nation, I'm Miles O'Brien.
That was a very interesting segment. It is amazing how much information is stored in every tree.
It is. There are so many interesting science stories, and we will feature a new episode of Science Nation each week.
I look forward to seeing more.
Me too.
As we head to the break, we have the word of the week. Each week, we highlight an advanced English word so that when you use them in a sentence, you can impress even educated speakers. If you like having an extensive and impressive vocabulary, try learning our word of the week.
Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
I remember how much you said you liked mine.
Oh.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of teens in foster care who would love to put up with you.
Give me back!
They'll test you. Try to break your will. But however loud the loudness gets, however many cheese puffs may fly, you're the driver, the one in control. Stand firm. Just wait. And move only when you hear the click that says they're buckled in for the drive. Never give up till they buckle up.
History's Timeline, a world of history in 60 seconds. Brought to you by New Hanover County Schools. 800 BC. Homer composes the epic poems, The Iliad and the Odyssey. 776 BC, the first Olympic Games are held in Greece. 551 BC, Confucius, the Chinese philosopher, is born. 509 BC, the Roman Republic is founded. 399 BC, Greek philosopher Socrates is condemned to death for his teaching. 355 BC, Alexander the Great is born. This has been History's Timeline, an educational snapshot of the fascinating people, places, and events that have shaped our past.
This is why you get by on 4 hours sleep. Why you took a second job. This is why you taught yourself how to fix the plumbing. And spend hours juggling the bills. This is why you'll do whatever it takes to keep your home. And that is why we want to help. We are making Home Affordable, a free government resource that can make paying the mortgage easier. Now more options are available. Call 888-995-HOPE to talk one-on-one with a housing expert today.
Looks like it's done.
Don't let salmonella get funky with your chicken. On average, 1 in 6 Americans will get a foodborne illness this year. You can't see these microbes, but they might be there. So learn the right temperature to cook each type of meat. Keep your family safe at foodsafety.gov.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. This is our first show of the year, and we're glad you are joining us.
During the summer break, there were a lot of administration changes in our school system.
Several principals were moved to new schools, while others were hired from outside the system to replace personnel who had been advanced.
To help you at home learn who went where and who was hired, we have a special segment we call NHCS New Faces, New Places.
Here we cover the principal changes which have taken place since the end of the last school year.
Sam Kandowich has been promoted to the new principal of the College Park Early Childhood Center. Mr. Kandowich has been serving as the assistant principal at Myrtle Grove Middle School. Regina Wooten has been promoted to be the new principal of Wilmington Early College High School. Previously, Ms. Wooten served as the program coordinator at the school. Dr. Laura Jennings has been promoted to be the new principal of Lake Forest Academy. Dr. Jennings has been serving as the assistant principal at Alderman Elementary. Philip Sutton has been transferred and will be the new principal of Murray Middle School. Mr. Sutton has been serving as the principal of Isaac Bear Early College High School. Susan Sellers is the new principal of Freeman Elementary. Ms. Sellers has been serving as the school transformation coach with the North Carolina Department of Public Instruction. Patrick McCarty has been transferred and will be the new principal of Ashley High School. Mr. McCarty has been serving as the principal of Murray Middle School. Mary Paul Beal has been transferred and will be the new principal of Isaac Bear Early College High School. Ms. Beal has been serving as the principal of Wrightsville Beach Elementary School. Bert Kilpatrick has been transferred and will be the new principal of Bellamy Elementary School. Mr. Kilpatrick has been serving as the assistant principal of Pine Valley Elementary. Dr. Jerry Martine is the new principal of Sunset Park Elementary. Dr. Martine has been serving as the education consultant for the North Carolina Department of Public Instruction. Jackson Norval has been transferred and will be the new principal of Wrightsville Beach Elementary School. Mr. Norval has been serving as the principal of Ashley High School. Ronald Vilnis is the new principal at Williston Middle School. Formerly, he served as the principal at Graham Middle School in Alamance County. Kristen Jackson is the new principal at Blair Elementary School. Formerly, she was the principal at Lake Forest Academy.
We hope you enjoyed that brief introduction to all the new and different principals we have. Each month here on The Morning Show, we will feature a more in-depth interview with one of our principals in our segment, Coffee with the Principal. Look for the first episode to air in mid-October.
All right, it's time now for this week's lunch menu. This is the menu for Monday, September 21st through Monday, September 28th. On Monday, September 21st, when lunchtime rolls around, you will have three delicious entrees to choose from. Feast on mouth-watering chicken nuggets with rice and gravy, a fine-tasting fish fillet sandwich, or a good old hot dog with chili. Whichever you choose, you can add sides of macaroni salad, sweet potato fries, a garden salad, or diced pears to your plate.
Then, on Tuesday, September 22nd, enjoy the fantastic flavor of chicken and waffles, Salisbury steak with a biscuit, or a hot, from-the-oven pizza slice. These scrumptious side items include red-skinned mashed potatoes with gravy, a garden salad, and fresh fruit.
On Wednesday, September 23rd, sit down with your friends and enjoy delightful orange chicken with rice, corn dog nuggets, or juicy bacon cheeseburger for lunch. Pick up glorious glazed carrots, garden salad, and tasty spiced apples on your way through the lunch line.
On Thursday, September 24th, embark on a delicious journey by treating yourself with either beefaroni with a breadstick, chicken fajita with Spanish rice, or a chicken fillet sandwich. And on your way to the table, be sure to pick up Great Northern beans, a garden salad, and fresh fruit.
Then, on Friday, September 25th, celebrate the upcoming weekend with a wonderful meal for lunch. Choose popcorn chicken with a roll, a meatball hoagie, or a pork chop sandwich. No matter your selection, these outstanding side items are included. Carrot sticks, a garden salad, and diced peaches.
Finally, on Monday, September 28th, awaken your taste buds with a flavor-packed chicken parmesan sandwich, a beef taco with Spanish rice, or eloquent French bread pizza. Also on the menu are barbecue pinto beans, a garden salad, and a frozen fruit cup.
And there you have the lunch menu for the week. In addition to those items, milk, a garden salad, French bread pizza, and peanut butter and jelly combo would be available daily.
So many delicious choices. Don't forget, you can also start your day off with a healthy and hearty breakfast at school. Bell Ringers is our next segment this morning, and it's from the C-SPAN classroom. This series features a biography of each of our country's presidents. Beginning with our first show of the school year, we start with our first president, George Washington. Each week, we'll feature the next president until we've covered them all and bring the series to a close next summer. Enjoy learning about the people who have led our country in this riveting series. Here's this week's episode of Bell Ringers.
No event could have filled me with greater anxieties than that of which the notification was transmitted by your order. On the one hand, I was summoned by my country, whose voice I can never hear but with veneration and love. On the other hand, the magnitude and difficulty of the trust to which the voice of my country called me could not but overwhelm with despondence one who ought to be peculiarly conscious of his own deficiencies. George Washington, First Inaugural Address, April 30th, 1789.
He was 57 when he became the nation's first president, chosen by all 69 members of the Electoral College, and to this day the only person unanimously elected to office. George Washington was one of the most famous men in the world by that time. His years as a Virginia statesman, as commander-in-chief of the Revolutionary Forces, and as president of the Constitutional Convention had secured him the kind of reputation few questioned. He was a towering figure physically as well. Nearly 6'3" and about 200 pounds, with a bony, muscular frame and size 13 boots. He had auburn hair, blue-gray eyes, and false teeth, which, contrary to conventional wisdom, weren't made of wood. Some sets were carved out of hippopotamus tusks, and others crafted from the teeth of cows. None of them fit him very well, and it's likely he was often in pain as a result. He was an Episcopalian and a Freemason, who dressed stylishly, loved to dance, and enjoyed spending evenings reading aloud to his wife. His favorite spot on earth was Mount Vernon, an inherited family estate located just south of what is now Washington, D.C. His greatest wish, he wrote, was to live and die there. When he was 26, he married Martha Dandridge Custis, reputedly the wealthiest widow in Virginia, who added 17,000 acres of land to Washington's 5,000 and 300 slaves to his 49. She was also a mother of two, and Washington became a devoted stepfather to young Jackie and Patsy. The Washingtons never had children of their own. He served from 1789 to 1797. John Adams was his vice president, Thomas Jefferson his secretary of state. He considered himself a political centrist, and it was to his chagrin that his administration coincided with the emergence of the nation's first two political parties, the Democratic Republicans under Jefferson and the Federalist under Alexander Hamilton. Refusing a third term, Washington retired to Mount Vernon in March of 1797. Once again, friends and associates called him general, a designation he preferred to president. After riding across his estate on horseback one snowy December afternoon, he developed a sore throat, which was later complicated by difficulty breathing. Three doctors attended him, bleeding him four times, a conventional treatment of the day. But his condition worsened, and he died shortly after 10 p.m. on December 14, 1799. He was 67.
As we head into a break, we continue our focus on our wonderful country with a new fun series of bumpers.
The United States has a rich, interesting history and a unique system of government. Knowing about our country is a very important part of being a good citizen.
Take our quick civics quiz and see what you know, or perhaps it will help you learn more about U.S. history and government.
What's going on?
I'm leaving.
Why? What did I do?
Not enough. You constantly ignore me. You barely eat anything healthy. You're half as active as you used to be. The pressure is just too much. I quit.
Okay, I get it. I'll do better. Just please, don't leave.
Okay. But remember, if I go, you go.
Listen to your heart. Don't let it quit on you. Uncontrolled high blood pressure could lead to stroke, heart attack, or death. Get yours to a healthy range before it's too late.
When I have an asthma attack, I feel scared. Sometimes my parents have to take me to the hospital. I feel like a fish with no water.
You know how to react to their asthma attacks. Here's how to prevent them. Call 1-866-NO-ATTACKS. Visit www.noattacks.org or call your doctor. Because even one attack is one too many.
Welcome back to The Morning Show. I'm July Alexander, and my co-host is Trevor Kerrigan, and we have some September segments of Snapshots.
In Snapshots, we take quick looks at some of the positive things going on around our school system, from fun projects to school-wide events to guest speakers and fabulous field trips. There's so many great things for our schools to celebrate.
New Hanover County Board of Education member Lisa Estep has been appointed to the North Carolina Board of Community Colleges by Governor Pat McCrory. Ms. Estep joins the others as a new members on the board and is sworn in on August 21st.
New Hanover County Schools held their summer school graduation ceremony last month at Snipes Academy of Arts and Design. The ceremony honored 13 students who completed their senior year coursework over the summer.
Students in Ms. White's fourth grade at Parsley Elementary had an exciting first day of school. They conducted a fun getting to know you activity. The students questioned their classmates to find which one matched up with which one of the descriptors on a puzzle. It was a good way for the new for them to learn about their fellow students.
The school year got off to an exciting start for the second grade students at Sunset Park Elementary when firemen from Station 3 visited. It was one of their Citizens in Our Community guest speaker series. In addition to the talk, the second graders had a chance to explore a fire truck.
Miss Sexton's class at Ashley High is already deep into performing labs. The students took part in a UNCW chemistry lab called the Spot Test. They were given a mixture of unknown chemicals and had to identify them through a series of chemical reactions.
The teachers at Carolina Beach Elementary appreciate the Island Women Group, which donated backpacks filled with supplies. The bags were loaded with tissues, cleaning wipes, glue sticks, and so much more. The teachers will use the supplies for class projects and to enhance student learning.
That was this month's Snapshots, a look at just a few of the many, many positives happening around our school system.
It's time for more Your School News, so let's send it back over to our news anchor, Gabrielle.
Thank you, July and Trevor, and welcome everyone to Your School News here on The Morning Show. New Hanover County Schools will be accepting governor's school applications September 15th through October 9th, 2015. Applications can be found at www.ncgovschool.org. Students must submit completed applications by 3 p.m. on October 9th to the governor's school contact at their high school in order to be considered for nomination.
The Governor's School of North Carolina is the oldest statewide summer residential program for gifted and talented high school students in the nation. The summer program is open to rising seniors, with the exception made for rising juniors in certain performing and visual arts.
On November 13, 2015, NHCS Governor's School academic and arts nominees will be submitted to the State Selection Committee by the school system. All Governor's School nominations must be made by the school system. No parents or individuals may nominate students directly to Governor's School. Nominees will be notified by mail of their status. For more information, you can contact Donna Sloan, Supervisor for Academically and Intellectually Gifted. As part of his ongoing charitable cause, Bob Moulton, the president of National PON, once again presented close to 100 instruments to the music program at DC Virgo Preparatory Academy. In addition, National PON donated $2,000 for repairs and maintenance of the instruments. This is the third year National PON has contributed to Virgo. The donation of the instruments makes it possible for everyone in Virgo's growing student population to be a part of the school's band or orchestra. If you have an instrument that you don't need or use anymore, you're encouraged to donate it to your local middle school. If you cannot donate it, Moulton says if you bring it to National PON, he will buy the instrument from you and then donate it to a middle school. Finally, Ashley High School Screaming Eagles Band and the North Carolina Band Masters Association will hold the first annual Screaming Eagle Invitational, a state-sanctioned high school marching band competition. 14 North and South Carolina High School marching bands will compete at Ashley High School for the title of the first annual grand champion of the Screaming Eagle Invitational. Bands will perform in 5 class sizes and be educated in music, visual, and general effect captions. This event is aligned with the North Carolina Band Masters Association as an official North Carolina state-sanctioned event. The Ashley High School Screaming Eagle Regiment will perform an exhibition before the grand champion is crowned. General admission will be $10 for adults, with children of preschool age and under admitted for free. Gates for the event open on Saturday, September 26th at 3 p.m., with the awards ceremony starting at 9:30. That's all for now. To watch this week's edition of Your School News online, visit the school system's website at www.nhcs.net and click on the NHCS TV logo on the homepage. Now back over to July and Trevor.
Thanks, Gabrielle. We bring our show to a close with a special edition of classic series, College Bound 411.
Historically, this series informed our viewing audience of college scholarships which are available in our area and our state.
However, this special edition is for students planning on attending college and shares tips on what they should be doing now at the beginning of the school year before the application processes begin.
As always with College Bound 411, it's a good idea to be ready to take notes if college is in your future or your child's future.
Here's our special back-to-school edition of College Bound 411.
For For students entering their senior year of high school, the early fall months can be a very exciting time. Having a group of established friends, as well as familiarity with the school and the teachers, helps seniors feel it is a good time to relax and enjoy life. It is important, however, that seniors take this time to prepare for life after high school, and those planning on going to college continue their college preparations. Here are a few good tips for college-bound students which can be done early in the senior year. Tip 1. Continue to visit schools. Fall is a great time to look at schools on your college list because classes are in session and you are better able to meet and talk with students and professors. You may even be able to sit in a class or two. Tip 2 is to finalize your college list. Use the information you gathered from college visits, interviews, and your own research to decide which schools you will apply to. It is okay to apply to colleges that you think will be more difficult to get into, but it's also important to put a few safety schools where you think you're sure to get in on your list. Talk to counselors, teachers, and parents about your final choices. Tip 3. Stay on track with your grades and extracurricular activities. Colleges will look at what you've done in your senior year, so stay focused, doing well in your classes, and maintaining your commitments to extracurricular activities. Tip 4. Take standardized tests. Register for and take the ACT, SAT, and SAT subject tests as necessary. Be sure you have requested that your test scores be sent to the colleges of your choice. This is also a good time to take these tests a second time if you took them during your junior year. Tip 5. Keep track of deadlines. You'll be filling out lots of forms this year, so it's important to know what form is due when. Make a calendar showing the application deadlines for admissions, financial aid, and scholarships. Tip 6. Ask for letters of recommendations. Give letter of recommendation forms to teachers you have chosen along with stamped, addressed envelopes so teachers can send them directly to the college. Be sure to fill out your name and address and the school name on each form. Discuss your goals and ambitions with your teachers so they'll be able to write a better letter. Tip 7. Meet your guidance counselor. Your counselor can help you stay on track with admission requirements. Make sure they know which colleges you want transcripts, school reports, and letters sent to. Give your counselors any necessary forms much earlier than actual deadlines so they have time to fill them out and send them in. Tip 8, complete applications. Finish the application forms for your school, the schools you're interested in. Proofread them and make extra copies before you send them. Make sure you and your guidance office have sent all the necessary materials, including test scores, recommendations, transcripts, and application essays. You should plan to get all this done before winter break so you won't be rushed to make deadlines. Tip 9. Continue your scholarship research. Apply for scholarships whose deadlines are approaching and keep searching for more, and also look for grant opportunities. Using online scholarship search tools is a great way to find potential aid. Ask colleges about what scholarships you may qualify for. The downtime after applications have been sent in is a great time to focus on financial aid. And our final tip, number 10, think about your future. The fall is a great time to think about what you want out of your college experience. What areas interest you and what possible majors can you choose? Are there any extracurricular activities you would like to participate in while you're at college? Where do you see yourself in 1, 5, and 10 years? Spend some time thinking about your future, and it will help set you on a path that will make you happy. College preparation is very important and can save you lots of time and stress. We hope these tips will aid you in eliminating a spring semester crunch and missing any deadlines which may affect your college career.
That was a lot of great information. And we hope everyone realizes the importance of preparing for college early on and not to wait until the last minute.
Well, that does it for this edition of The Morning Show. Remember, for the best TV of all, each and every day, keep it tuned right here for the New Hanover County Schools TV on the Learning Network of the Cape Fear.
Have a great day.
And a wonderful week.